guys, welcome to my channel. My name is Reading Bear and I hope you are ready for some more stories. And today, we will take a look at some new Pori Ranch content.
If you enjoyed my content, please don't forget to subscribe to my channel and post some bear emojis in the comment. And now, let's dive right into the stories.
First one is titled, Half-Brothers Threaten to Sue Me Over 16K. It costs them 158K and possibly their parents' marriage. When I, 25 female, was 3, my grandparents passed away. They set up a savings account in my name. The account was meant to be accessed by me when I was 21. At that point it contained just over 300K. My grandparents left me a letter saying they would like me to share the money fairly with any other Smith Jones children, meaning my full siblings. Dad's a Smith, Mum's a Jones. By fairly, they meant that they wanted me to assess the situation and judge for myself what was fair. I never had full siblings, but I have two half-brothers, Mac and Joe Smith, who are Dad and Stepmum's kids. Due to the specific wording my grandparents used, I legally never had to give Mac or Joe any money. However, I see Mac and Joe as my brothers, and as the money came from our grandparents, I felt that the fairest thing would be to assign each of us 100K, so we all got an equal-sized lump sum, and I figured that when Mac, the youngest, turned 21 and took his 100K, we could split any remaining money. When I turned 21, Dad suggested I buy a house with my 100K. I found a place I loved, but it was 130K and I couldn't get a mortgage, so Dad said I should borrow 30K from the account. I did, figuring I could pay it back before my brothers turned 21, and I have been repaying it. The account should be at 208K right now, but due to me withdrawing and then repaying that money it's at 195K, so I still owe 13K. Joe turned 21 recently, and as I was giving him his 100K, Joe noticed that there was less in the account than there should be. I explained and said I was going to put it all back before Mac, now 19, turns 21. Joe told Mac and both boys said I stole from them and owed them the full 13K back plus 3 grand of interest that they felt they would have gotten, and they wanted it all paid by this summer, which gave me less than 6 months to bring the account up to 211K. I said I'd do it, but over 2 years as planned. The boys then wrote up a contract to that effect. I went to sign it, until I saw that it said 6 months to pay it all back. I wouldn't sign as we agreed on 2 years. They said I should figure it out as they were entitled to that money and would be seeking legal advice. Later that day I got an email, clearly written by them, saying that they intend to sue me for the 16K, plus whatever is currently in the account, and additional damages and emotional distress on top of that. At this point in time, I'd given Joe about 50K of his 100K, because he wanted it in installments. I responded that legally, they were never entitled to any of it, and given their attitudes, I'd say they've already received an amount I deem fair, so that 50K was all they were getting. I then got a barrage of texts, calls, and emails yelling at me for going back on our deal. I blocked them. They then took to social media, saying that I was trying to screw them out of their inheritance and rallying our extended family into harassing me over this, and it mostly worked as a lot of people messaged me. However, I got a message from this guy called Chris Smith. Chris said he was 27, and claimed to be my half-brother. I had never met him before, but he sent me photos of him as a kid with our dad, grandparents, and me. He showed me that he also had an account with 150K in it, and a scan of a letter from our grandparents, saying this money was meant to be shared fairly among Dad's illegitimate children. Chris also told me we have another half-sibling, who is 18. He'd been looking for me for a while, but only found me when Dad shared Joe's post which had me tagged. We checked with a solicitor to make sure, and as the boys are legitimate, they aren't entitled to anything in Chris' illegitimate kid fund, and as they are my half-siblings, they aren't entitled to anything in my Smith Jones kids fund, either. I sent the boys a letter formally telling them to back off. Stop posting about me online, and enjoy the 50K because it's all they're getting. The day they received the letter, Chris got a PM from Dad, asking if the boys can have some of Chris' fun. Chris also said no, and told Dad we'd met. I told Mac and Joe about Chris and our other half-sibling, with Chris' permission. So it looks like my grandparents, knowing about Chris before they passed, set up two funds. One for the kids Dad had with my mother, who was still his wife when they passed, and one for children born out of Dad's affairs, presumably to make sure no one tried to screw anyone else over out of hurt feelings. I'm getting a lot of shit, but holding firm on my decision. The boys have realized that I won't back down on this, and it sounds like I've caused a schism at their house, as Joe has all the money and no intention of sharing, so Mac is now feeling twice as screwed. Plus stepmom apparently did not know about the other half-siblings, or that my half-sister was born after she and Dad got married, and she's made Dad move into a hotel. It sounds like Dad is looking for a long-term living arrangement outside of the family home, because it looks like she is not letting him move back in. Dad is begging me to reconsider, but honestly I'm done with all of them except Chris and my sister. Next one is titled, I got my horrible landlord's girlfriend to dump him. Truthfully, it was best for everyone involved. My first apartment out of college, I lived next door to my landlord in an old, broken-down building. The walls were paper thin, so I could hear everything and knew a lot about him. He was a drug addict named Blaine who lived with his girlfriend. They frequently got into loud fights that included screaming and throwing things. Blaine referred to his girlfriend as the woman I am cohabitating with, and she referred to him as her fiancé, although I knew from eavesdropping that he had never proposed. Blaine and his girlfriend were unethical business people with a bad reputation in the community. I had no pets but came home one day to find a note taped to my door. The note was handwritten in red ink, very unprofessional, and stated that they had discovered my illegal pet on the premises and that I was going to be evicted in 3 days. I left Blaine a voicemail explaining that there must be a mistake because I did not have a pet. I even offered to let him walk through my apartment to check. He ignored my call. I typed a letter stating the same thing. He ignored it. On the third day, I was scared that my possessions were going to be thrown out, so I called the police. The policeman listened to my story, and while I was talking, we heard Blaine and his girlfriend arguing in the next unit over, so we knew they were home. The policeman knocked on the door. The window shades were open, and we could see Blaine walk up to the window. He saw me standing there with the policeman, drew the shades, and walked away. Never answered the door. The police took care of Blaine, but I decided to get back at him. Having heard all the fights with his girlfriend, I went on the web to multiple battered woman websites and signed up for subscriptions in her name and address. Within a week, they had a barrage of mail about domestic violence and a visitor from social services. One day, Blaine came knocking at my door. It was the first time I'd seen him since the illegal pet situation. He apologized profusely, blamed it all on his now ex-girlfriend, and offered to lower my rent. Then, before leaving, he said, "By the way, if you see my ex creeping around, call the police." "Why would she be creeping around?" I asked. "We broke up, and all her stuff is still in my garage. I'm not planning to give it back," he replied. "Actually, you should come look and see if you want anything before I burn it all." Sure enough, that night, he held a bonfire in the yard and burned all her possessions. I was worried because fire and drug addicts don't tend to mix well, so I called the fire department and reported it. I watched out my back window as the fire truck pulled up, and Blaine ran away. That was the last time I ever saw him. Next one is titled, Moving On to Someone Better. When I was in college, my girlfriend was cheating on me and became pregnant by the other guy. She told me what happened. I told her that she needed to work it out with the other guy and broke up with her. A week later, I was studying for the LSAT exam in the library and I saw an incredibly attractive and exotic young woman. She looked just like a swimsuit model that I'd seen in a national advertising campaign. That's because she was here. I said to myself, "Dude, go up to her. The worst that could happen is that she'll blow you off." Instead, I got digits from one of the nicest women that I've ever met. She wanted to go to the San Francisco Opera that weekend. I offered reservations for dinner at a 4-star restaurant just for fun. That night, I dressed in a suit that my ex-girlfriend really liked. The phone rang. I answered. It was my ex-girlfriend. She asked me how was it going. I said that I had to leave in a minute and that I was dressed in my suit and heading to San Francisco. She was upset and said that she just had an abortion that afternoon and that the father, who was also her boss, had taken her to the clinic, paid for it, and then broke up with her and fired her. She then begged me to come over to her home immediately because she was having a rough time. I told her that this was awful in a rather condescending and cocky way. I then told her that I had met someone else, that she was a model, and that she was my date that night at the SF Opera. I told her how she could find pics of my newfound friend's latest modeling shoot. The other phone started to ring. I put my ex-girlfriend on hold. My date was calling me. She gushed on about how excited she was about that evening and asked me to come pick her up as soon as possible. I told her that I'd be right over and went back to the other phone. I told my ex that my date had called and that I had to leave immediately. My ex started to cry. I said goodbye and ended the call and proceeded on to one of the best evenings of my life. This is all true. You don't need to do anything to get revenge on people. Most of the time, they do it all for you. Next one is titled, He Discouraged Me From Obtaining My Dream, So I Achieved It Anyway. My very first job was as an ice cream server for an amusement park at the age of 15. For US$4.47 per hour, I would serve cones, sundaes, banana splits, and milkshakes for 20 to 30 hours per week. While this sounds like a fun job, and it was mostly, it was also stressful at times. During July and August, when the park was at its busiest, there could be huge long lines, non-stop waves of people. It could be really hard work. But no matter how busy it was, at certain times in the afternoon, I could always look forward to seeing the park's hired brass band setting up across the food court, and hear them play for about 20 minutes. As someone who had just recently discovered that the trombone was my instrument, I was highly ambitious and absolutely convinced that if only I could get an opportunity, I could go places. I listened to the band with longing as I scooped ice cream, and said to myself, I'm going to play in that band one day. My coworkers all knew that I played the trombone. At that time it was still somewhat weird for a girl to play trombone, so when I told people that I played it, the response was usually a confused, that's nice, or, how interesting. But I didn't care. I wore a necklace with a trombone charm on it to work every day, total band nerd. And didn't care that my coworkers thought I was weird. Once, on a slow day, my boss was there and joking around with all of us. Everyone was in a good mood. I forget what we were talking about, but during the conversation, the brass band started setting up nearby like they always did. For some reason, maybe it was relevant to what we were talking about. I excitedly told my coworkers and boss that it was my dream to play trombone with the amusement park band. My boss thought this was a huge joke. He laughed and laughed, and looked at me like I was totally nuts. He said something like, forget it, that'll never happen. Like I'd just declared I wanted to grow gills and breathe underwater. Then a customer showed up, and my boss left to do other things. I felt hurt and confused. An adult, my boss, had just laughed at my dream and said to my face, you can't do that. Was he right? I felt ashamed and stupid and wanted to cry. But very quickly, those feelings turned to anger, then defiance, then determination. That day, my dream became my goal. Long story short, a year later, a parade was held at the amusement park to celebrate Independence Day. The parade wound through the park and happened to pass by the food court. The ice cream stand was very busy because of the holiday weekend. As I marched by with my bandmates, playing my heart out as the crowd cheered and clapped, I could see the huge long line at the ice cream stand, and my former co-workers running back and forth, yelling, I can help the next guest. In fact, it was so busy that my boss was there alongside them, helping to scoop ice cream himself. He looked tired and stressed. He happened to look up as the parade went by. I stared until he saw me. I swear to you, his eyes bugged and his jaw dropped, and the expression on his face was something indescribable. He quickly regained his composure and got back to work, but that moment was such sweet revenge. Next one is titled, She Stole $80 From Me, Then months later, she got into my cab. So, I worked with this person. She stole $80. I was a server. There was nothing I could do, and I wasn't getting my money back, and I knew it. Months later, I had found a new job. I get a call from my old place of employment. Yes, I need a cab to so-and-so. I recognized the voice. I was the cab driver. I knew it was her. I go anyway. When I arrive, there she is smiling. I said, $80 to get in this cab, babe. And I just looked at her and smiled back. You can't do that. I know the company. I'm calling you in. I know the owner. I laugh and I'm like, yeah, I know him too. He's the guy that hired me. But if you want in this particular cab, there's an $80 deposit. If you don't want to walk home in the rain, there's an $80 upfront fee. Now this whole time, I have the window cracked. And literally nothing else is unlocked. She was so mad. I smiled ear to ear and say, hey, remember ducking me out of $80? She said, duck you, you're a cabbie now, and you have a duty to customer service. I said, well, just slip a hundo through the window. She was absolutely livid. You can't do this. This is an assault. I need a ride home, now. I was like, yep, I need my money back, honey. But what could she do? I drove away smiling. Karma, sometimes, is a mother. Last one is titled, She Peed in His Prized Sports Car. My buddy, we will call him Hugo, had one of those Nissan 300Z, or some fancy concept sports car. We were all parked at our buddy Chavez's place having a grand old time. A group of hot girls came by who I've never seen before. One of the girls, we will call her Peru, started screaming at Hugo. It ducked everyone's mood up. We all told him to shut Peru up, so we could get back to having fun. Well, Hugo decided to hide in the bathroom. But Hugo left his keys on Chavez's desk. Peru noticed them. The next thing I hear is Chavez shout, hey, everyone come see what Peru is doing. I run on the porch, pretty messed up at this point. And the sight was just grand, as it was not my car. Peru had turned the car on, opened the sunroof, took her pants off and began to pee in the sunroof. Funniest revenge I saw. Anyway, Hugo rushes out and like an idiot tries to climb in the car and close the sunroof. She is done at this point and begins putting her pants on. And then she slams the door on his butt, and he goes face first in her part pee. Poor Hugo. She said he cheated. He did, and we all knew as I thought another girl was his girlfriend. Thanks for listening.